Well, hello, good morning. Happy Sunday. How are we doing today? Yeah? Awesome, awesome. It's so good to see all of you. Go ahead and turn to those around you and say good morning and welcome, and we'll keep going just a little bit.
Any
amen, amen. You guys can have a seat. Let's pray. God, we thank you for that this morning. We thank you for your unfailing love, God. God, we thank you that you've been where we are and you've been further than we are, God. And we know that you see the full outcome, God. God, so even in times that we're confused, we don't know what's going on, and we're scared or we're mad or we're upset, God, you've already seen the outcome. And you've seen us pull through. God, we just thank you so much for that. The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to try.
You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn. Everybody, it's good to see you guys. Welcome to Cokesbury. My name is Stephen. I'm the senior pastor here, and if this is your first time with us, we are glad that you guys are here. I want to say good morning to everyone sitting in Overflow and everyone watching online. It's good to be able to gather together as God's people, and we're honored that you guys are here. We're going to dismiss our kids now. If you're new, we like to have kids in worship, and then we send them off to hear a message about Jesus. You're always welcome to go with them. We've got K through first in the back. Second through fourth grade to my right, and fifth and sixth graders to my left. It's always good to watch. I mean, look at this. It's just great to see so many kids engaged in worship, and they're going to go have a great time. The thing I love about what we do here is if you ask your son or daughter after church what they learned, they're going to be able to tell you that. And we've got a tremendous team of people who work with them and who will share the love of Christ with them, and it's going to be a great experience. Want to just give you a heads up while they're making their way out of the room. Next week starts Holy Week. It'll begin next Sunday on our traditional campus with their Easter music. I know this time of year, a lot of us, maybe you grew up with a more traditional music background. That's a great way to start off Holy Week. And so if you want to catch that, you can do that during our normal worship times next week. And then we've got a whole week full of opportunities for you starting on Thursday with Holy Thursday. There's two Good Friday services, one at lunch, one in the evening. And then Easter Sunday, we've got a wide variety of services beginning at sunrise right out behind me here on this campus. If you've never been to a sunrise service, it's really pretty cool. So I would encourage you to catch that. A lot of people will come to sunrise and then hang around and catch the first Easter worship in the room. For you guys, I want to remind you that that starts a brand new worship times for us here on this campus. So starting on Easter Sunday, it'll be 9, 10:15, and 11:30. And the reason we need to do that is because we are growing like crazy, and we want to make sure that at this hour in particular, we have space for folks who are visiting us. And so beginning on Easter into perpetuity, we're going to go 9, 10:15, 11:30. And so I would like to ask you to consider going to one of those other two services. That would help make room for folks if you're not attached and like 10 is mission critical for you and your family. Consider showing up at 9 or 11:30. That would be fantastic. We're also looking for folks who can take their next step and become greeters for us as we add that 9 o'clock service. So if that is something that you guys are interested in, you, anyone in your family, if you'll see Jill out in guest services, she'll get you signed up, coached up, and we will turn you loose. And so I hope that you guys will help us with that. It helps us put our best foot forward as folks are coming in, trying to navigate our building and figure things out if we have smiling, wonderful faces. So if you are an overly bitter person, this is not for you, right? But if you can make the muscles in your face work and smile, you can even be an introvert like me, and you can greet people. It'll be awesome. So we would love for you guys to help us out with that. We're going to continue in our worship this morning. We're going to receive our morning offering, and I just want to let you guys know how grateful I am for you. We've been together a long time, and your generosity is overwhelming, and it is impressive, and I can't thank you guys enough. It allows us every single day of the week to reach out into our community and to impact people's lives, and so I just want to say thanks in advance. There's a lot of different ways you can give. You can see it on the screen here behind me. But your willingness to participate in what God is doing here, I think, is what sets the table for life change in our community. And so I'm going to invite our friends that are going to help us receive the offering this morning to come on up. And while they do that, let's pray together. Gracious God, it is good to be in your house. And I give you thanks for the way that you are moving and working, not just here at this church, but all across our community, the way that you impact people, the way that you warm hearts, that you connect people together. And Lord, I'm grateful that we all get to play a part in that. And I pray as we receive this morning's offering that you do what you do best, that you take those gifts that we offer, that you'll multiply them, and that over the next 7 days till we see each other again, that you'll direct us to the right people where that those resources can impact them the most. God, I pray for Mark as he comes to teach in just a few moments. I pray that your Holy Spirit will be thick in this room, that you will step through him, and that by the time we're through, we'll all have the assurance that we have stood on holy ground in your presence. For it is in the name of the resurrected Jesus that we pray. Amen.
Doing all right? Aren't you loving this new sound system? Man, it's just like you can hear every chord, you can hear all kind of stuff we never, pretty much never heard before. I'm just grateful. So my name is Mark, believer in Jesus Christ. Glad to be teaching with you. I'm one of the pastors and serves here, and I work with do a lot of work with recovery ministry. So we do that on Thursday nights, starting with dinner at 5:30, and we start worship at 6:30. Group's about 7:40, so if that's something that would be helpful for you, come and hang out with what we're doing. So, let's pray. Jesus, thank you for just spending time with us this morning, for moving into our hearts, for moving into our thoughts, for challenging our thoughts and our presuppositions. And we thank you for the way that you love us, even when, like we're going to learn today, even when we don't really understand, at least at first blush, what you're trying to say to us. So we love you for that. We love you for your patience. In your sweet name we pray, amen. So my daughter, who has children, referred to right now in our family as like the golden child because she has grandkids, they did something that I thought was kind of insane, but they took all three of their kids to Pigeon Forge to that Wolf Lodge, whatever that place called, and I'm sitting there thinking, my God, woman, is that all? Did I ever teach you anything? Like, why are you doing this to yourself? Well, so they decided it was going to work. It was going to be perfect and stuff. And there's so much to do. It's like, yeah, there's too much to do. That's kind of the way that works out. But anyway, so they get there and I get the full report the next day. And so I go, how was it? Well, what they had is they had their own room, and then they had what's where their littlest was their daughter was going to stay. And so then the boys were supposed to stay in another room. Total disaster, because like those boys cannot figure out how to sleep together to save their life. It doesn't really matter. They could be dead tired. It doesn't really matter what they do. And so every single time they try to do it, you know, it's just a deal. And so by Thursday, they're driving home. And so I go, well, so what do you think now? She goes, Dad, never again. There isn't a house big enough in Pigeon Forge for us to stay there. I'm like, yeah, kind of thought that might be possible. But the only thing they were having a good time, I guess, was when they were on, they're in that water, you know, inside water park. And so she's like, so I was sitting there going, you know, he was on that the wave runner, the wave thing. She goes, I'm thinking to myself, Maybe now that kid would it would benefit him by being more humble. It really didn't do that, of course. But they have one kid that's very sensitive. Their oldest child is very sensitive, very interested in doing quote the right thing. My daughter has figured out that their middle child, Holden, she goes, Dad, I swear to you, the more time I spend around him, he just doesn't care. Like he looks at you when you tell him something, and he smiles the way he smiles, like. And he just looks at you like, yeah, you know, it's never gonna happen, Mom. It's just, why would you do that? Like, why would you do that? And then you have the littlest, who is a complete, in every way, charmer. Like, she is just, she's the golden child because she's the daughter, she's the girl. And so the amount of attention she gets, all you have to do is go look in their closets. Look in their boys' closets. They have a decent amount of clothes. Look in her closet, every single rack, and they've added that another rack. Every single rack is full of clothes. So, I mean, I'm just saying. So, we got a story today. Well, by the way, I want to welcome people that are joining us online. So, thank you for being a part of us. Give it up for these guys. And we got a story going on today. In the Gospel of Matthew, I'm going to read you in a minute. And so this story is like a classic family story. If you have kids that are about that age now, or if you remember having kids that were at one point that age, you know, like one of the biggest conversations in a large size, a decent sized family, where there's at least more than one kid, is what? When you're going to ride in the car, I'm sure they had that conversation going over to Pigeon Forge. You ready? Who gets to ride shotgun, right? Who gets to ride in the front seat? When I was growing up, my mom had we had six kids. So my mom had this massive tank-like station wagon, you know, like with wood on the sides and stuff like that, all the cool things. And so it was the first car we ever had that was air-conditioned, because I think she threatened my father with an inch of his life that you are gonna get me an air-conditioned car. And so anyway, I don't know if she said that or not, but I can imagine her saying that. And so the big fight in our family wasn't who was going to ride shotgun, because that would have always been my mom. You would never have outvoted her. But it was like, who got to sit in the far back seat? Maybe you remember this and maybe you don't, because maybe you don't, but it was kind of like flying Southwest. At one point when you flew Southwest, you could fly in a seat that was looking in the opposite direction. Anybody remember that? Yeah, you could get on like that very front seat. You could fly in a seat that you could be looking at somebody. I always thought that was pretty cool. They're gone now, but anyway, you in this station wagon, you got to look at the opposite view. Loved it, man. Like, and there was a major battle for who got to climb back there and sit in that back seat, even though back in the day there was like no air conditioning back there or nothing. You know, you wouldn't have gotten any hardly any air. There wasn't like vents all over the place like there are now. And that was a big, big league battle. There was like all kinds of conversations about that, all kind of bartering. When we got older, we kind of learned how to barter, make trades for stuff, all kinds of weird stuff, bugs, everything else. We would sell, like, I remember selling my sister one time an actual bug, you know, like an ant or whatever. It's like, I'll sell you my 5 ants for sitting back there. Okay. Anyway, this store we're going to get into takes us to that kind of a place. Like, I want you to think about that kind of times 10, but it's sort of the question of who gets to ride shotgun. That's where we're going to start. So we're starting in Matthew chapter 20, and here's how the story goes. And I kind of love how, I don't know if it's true or not, but I kind of love how, you know, one commentator was saying that these brothers in this story were young enough that the mom felt the need to kind of like do their bidding. So maybe that's true, maybe that's not. But anyway, it goes like this. When the mother of James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to Jesus with her sons, she knelt respectfully to ask for a favor. "What's your request?" Jesus asked. She said, "In your kingdom, could you please let my two sons sit in places of honor next to you, one on your right and one on your left?" Jesus says something really startling. Jesus answered by saying to them, "You don't know what you're asking. Are you able to drink from the bitter cup of suffering I am about to drink?" "Oh, yes," they replied, "we are able." You want to go, "Are you? Are you? Do you want to rethink that?" "Oh, yes, we're able." Jesus told them, "You will indeed drink from my bitter cup, but I have no right to say who's going to sit on my left or on my right. My Father has prepared those places for the ones he has chosen." When the 10 other disciples, you can imagine this, right? You can imagine, like, take the scene I just painted for you about who was sitting where in the car, who's sitting shotgun or whatever, a reverse shotgun. Think of that and think of this right here. When the 10 other disciples heard what James and John had asked, because what they're asking for is, when you come into your kingdom, when we're in eternity, for eternity, can the brothers sit at your right and your left? When they had heard what James and John had asked, they were indignant. I love that word. They were indignant. But Jesus called them together and said, "You know that the rulers of this world lord it over people, their people, and officials flaunt their authority over those under them. But among you, it's just going to be different." And you can imagine right now they're going like, "How different? What's different? Like, this is kind of like what we know. We're good with this. We're good with like the sort of class system thing. We're good with like order of age or whatever, seniority, whatever it is. Like, among you, it will be different. Whoever wants to be a leader among you has got to be your servant." Can you imagine? "Whoever wants to be a leader among you has got to be your servant. And whoever wants to be first among you must become your slave. For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve others and to give his life as a ransom for many." The Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life for a ransom for many. There's a book that if you're in any kind of leadership role, I would really commend this book to you. You can find it on Amazon or whatever. It's called Servant Leadership. Not a big book, but kind of honestly an important book. It talks about a lot of these features. And so you come out of that scripture, Matthew 20, you go, man, what a mess these guys are as disciples. Like, think how they've been walking around with Jesus for a while now. It's gone. They've been with him for years. And this is basically as far as their perspective has gotten, right? This is as far as their perspective has grown. This is kind of like what they have picked up in all their time with walking around with Jesus himself. Not trying to read the Bible, not whatever, because they didn't really have that. But I mean, walking around with Jesus, the man. How is that the best you can get to? Like, what a mess these guys are. We start off with what we're talking about today. Like, Jesus does, he loves us. He, like, loves us where we are a mess. We are a mess, too. I mean, like, we would like to go down this path of, I mean, fairness. One of the most attractive things, one of the most attractive pieces of teaching in Christian circles, I guess, is sort of like the deal of reciprocity. You know, like you do good things for God and God will be really nice to you. You bring God favor and God will bring you favor. And that's kind of the way, because the thing is, that's kind of like the system that we know, isn't it? That's kind of like what we believe is kind of the good thing. Like, we work hard, we get rewarded, we do this. It's sort of like the reciprocity thing, you do this, like, right? And so Jesus is going to challenge this to the nth degree in this story. We're a mess, I think, because we believe that to be true. We want to believe that if we're really good Christian people, if we really do good Christian things, only good stuff is going to happen to us. But, you know, and we can see, whether we want to believe it or not, we can see in our own life, I mean, that sense of fairness or equity, like, God has a different value set. He has a different value set than just what I guess the world would lift up as a value set of fairness, equity. You know, one of the things the world's going to lift up is, and one of the reasons we find ourselves having this mess in understanding this scripture is because what is causing the mess in this story pretty much always causes the mess in our lives, in our relationships, in what goes on with our families, in what goes on in our marriages, in what goes on with our extended family. It causes us problems right, left, and sideways. What always seems to cause the mess comes down to two things, I think. Item number one, the quest for power. The belief that if I just have enough power, everything's going to be okay. It's kind of like look at the Wizard of Oz movie. There's a lot of stuff I don't really like in that movie that I don't think is very good theology at all. One of the things I do like is the way that they kind of address the understanding of power. I mean, the lion has no power whatsoever. He's a timid, scared little kitty cat, but he really would like to express his false sense of power, wouldn't he? Power is one of those problems. What causes the mess? The other problem is fear. Fear for us causes all kinds of messes. All kinds of messes. So you got the disciples, and Jesus is telling them about drinking this cup and all of that, and the kind of suffering that he's going to endure and that they're going to go through. And so they go. At least two of the brothers, I don't know if everybody still chimes in, but the two brothers go, man, Jesus, we are ready. You got the right boys. You got the right people at the right time. We're ready. We're ready for whatever you want to bring. We know everything we need to know. It's fine. We're willing to do whatever it is you want us to do. We are ready. How do they know they're ready? They know they're ready because they're speaking out of power. They're speaking out of power. They want to believe that their power can overcome whatever it is that Jesus is going to put in front of them. But what they're also speaking out of is fear. Because if for some fleeting moment their power is unavailable to them, if for some fleeting moment they feel powerless, wouldn't that for them be in a lot of ways worse than accepting the challenge? That, hey, whatever it is you're telling us to do, Jesus, we're good. We're good. If I stand there in front of Jesus and I go, man, what you're asking me to do, the kind of suffering you're asking me to accept or to share with you, that's kind of overwhelming. They don't want to say that. They don't want to talk about the fact that, you know what, Jesus, I mean, like, man, I'm afraid. It's like if you read stories of people that, in as far as I know it, were like extraordinarily close people to Jesus, people that have demonstrated an intimate closeness to Jesus throughout their whole life. I can think of people off the top of my head that are people like that. One of them is Billy Graham. And when you read about Billy Graham, to me, Billy Graham looked like this guy that was unbelievably confident, totally sure of himself, basically fearless, you know, ready for any challenges. But when you read stories about Billy Graham, and when Billy Graham talks about himself, what do you learn? You learn that there were a lot of nights when he was going to go in front of 100,000 people, and Billy Graham was just terrified. There's another pastor, Louis Giglio, who writes even more clearly about some of his concerns or some of the stuff that happens to him. There are a couple of different books he talks about this. He's the pastor of this large church, Atlanta, and also D.C., Passion City Church. I kind of really follow this guy. I admire him as a teacher. I think he's a great teacher. And I mean, to listen to this guy, he has crazy confidence. I would like to have the confidence that guy has. Like, I would like to have it. I mean, it's just kind of amazing to me. Like, it just kind of rolls, these conversations in him kind of roll, they're like they roll out of him. Well, then what do I learn? It was a few years ago I learned this. I learned that Louis Giglio has incredible, of all things, incredible stage fright. So I learned that on a lot of Sundays when he starts to teach, he is kind of like thrown up once or twice before he started teaching. He suffers from all kinds of anxiety about being in public. And you're like, how in the world is that possible? And you look at that storyline and you're like, well, God is clearly fully involved in this guy's life, because how else is he doing it? I thought it was amazing that he talked about his fear that way. He was just that open about it. If you're Louis Giglio and Jesus starts talking to you about suffering and the cup of suffering, Giglio would have said, you know what? I mean, he would be like, I'm not really ready. And not only am I not ready, but I'm outright afraid. I think those are important conversations for us to have, because is there any piece of Jesus anywhere where if we get to a place with him and we're not sure what to do next and we've run out of options, it's kind of called hitting a bottom in a lot of cases, but we've run out of options, we've run out of ways to do it on our own. Maybe you're there today where you have run out, you have tried every solution you could have possibly known to try. You've read 9 different books on all kinds of stuff about you as you see it, and here you are today, and you're like, man, none of it's working. None of it is working. So my question for you would be like, have you ever thought of getting to a place where you're like, you know what? 2 things are happening to me. Just like these guys, I don't think they saw it, but this is what Jesus is calling them to. first thing happening to me is like, I really have realized that I'm powerless. I'm like, I'm powerless over this. I'm powerless over what's happening at work. I'm powerless over what's happening with my children. I'm powerless over, which is one of the hardest places to feel powerless, I really think. Amen? I do. I'm powerless over my parents and what's happening to them. I'm powerless over their health. I'm powerless over my health in a lot of ways because I can't predict what's going to happen. And the other piece is, like, I'm afraid. Well, those are not necessarily bad places to be, as opposed to going, we're ready. We got it. We got it all. Whatever it is, we got it. Because when you say you got it, it kind of eliminates the opportunity for people to come into your life and be a resource, amen? For other people to come into you and speak to you. For other people to come into your life who God is going to speak through, and I think we should be looking for people like that, who God is going to speak through, because we eliminate those voices and we go, I got it. And can you imagine God going, hello, I think I have some other things to show you, like chapters. I got chapters to show you. I got volumes of stuff to talk to you about. I got volumes of stuff to teach you. And now you have shut it down. A problem becomes a massive problem when we shut down God, amen? When we decide that we don't want God involved in our life in any way, we will handle it from here. We'll take it from here. We are our own wisdom base. I think we're in a lot of trouble. We don't have that kind of openness. I think we're in a lot of trouble. One of the pieces that's going to come out of that situation when we're in that place is, how are we going to share in the healing of our corner of the world when we don't really want to seek out our own healing? It's like what I would call the great servant leveler. In order for me to become a servant of other people and the world in general, in order for me to become a servant, I got to realize that, you know what? I actually need Jesus. I actually need stuff from Jesus in my life. I'm actually not self-sufficient. I'm actually not all-knowing. I'm actually not all-powerful. I'm actually not all-encompassing of all my resources. I don't have them. I don't have them. The great servant leveler. So the great servant leveler comes into play when you kind of ask these questions. Number one, if I were to ask you, what are you a slave to right now, what would it be? Slave to work, slave to schedule, slave to health, slave to fear, slave to some kind of a relationship, slave to your pain, physical, emotional, spiritual, mental, slave to that. What are you a slave to right now? When you ask that question, one way to get at it is, okay, let's look at it this way. What would you say right now this morning is dominating your thoughts and your actions? What would you say is dominating your thoughts and your actions? What would you say you can't stop thinking about? Does that have a name? Does that have a feeling? Does that have an emotion? Does that have a reality base? Is it accurate? Is it real? Is it legitimate? It's kind of like, you know, one of the anacronyms of fear is false evidence appearing real. False evidence appearing real. What can you not stop thinking about this morning? We are built in such a way that we can literally get swallowed whole inside of ourselves and in our pain, right? We can get swallowed whole inside of ourselves and inside of our pain. Here's the thing. What we believe we have ultimate power over, with no intervention from God, no guidance from God, no words from Jesus, no modifications, no, have you ever thought about, what we believe we have ultimate power over will also become our greatest fear. If I believe I have $100 million in the bank, that'd be nice, but if I believe I have $100 million in the bank, and I don't understand the servant life, and I don't understand generosity, and I don't understand anything like that, what am I worrying about? I wonder what could happen before I lost it. I wonder what could happen. How could I have lost that? How could I lose that? So what we believe we have power over, ultimate power over, can and will become what we fear. It'll become what we fear because of the fear of losing it. I might be trying to, maybe there's somebody in my life and I've decided that the best way that I can keep her or keep him in my life is to try to basically control them some kind of a way. It's like, there was a series called I, Marriage that I really was very fond of a few years ago. And so one of the things that I, Marriage teaches is, what do I actually owe my spouse? Do I actually owe my spouse anything? Well, outside of the parameters of marriage, which define fidelity and those kinds of features, do I actually owe my spouse anything? I really don't. It's hard to hear, but I really don't. What would be even more healthy is if I'm like, I don't owe her. It's not a debtor relationship, but I'm going to give her this part of my life. I'm going to give her this piece of me. I'm going to give her what she's asking me for. I'm going to give it to her. It's going to be a gift. That's even more powerful. What we fear is what we are fearing we are going to lose. And without the heart of the servant, without that kind of servant power, the thing is, fear is always going to dominate because fear really is our ultimate vulnerability. I worry about what I'm going to lose. I worry about how I'm going to hang on to something when that really isn't mine in the first place. Love, look at a relationship. Love really belongs to Jesus. It doesn't really belong to me. My children really belong to Jesus. They don't really belong to me. My grandchildren belong to Jesus. I keep telling Aaron that. I'm like, yeah, your middle kid that you think is driving you crazy, just go, get up every day and go, that kid belongs to Jesus. You're good. I'm like, you got a good reason right there. Like, just say, Holden belongs to Jesus. I like that. You know, so that vulnerability is a big deal. I mean, I think one of the questions that comes out of this scripture is this one. You saw the word ransom there, right? You know that word? Like, what does ransomed mean? How do I live a ransomed life? I live a ransomed life when I realize that Jesus has freed me from myself. I live a ransomed life when I realize that Jesus has freed me from myself. And when I realize that I was bought and paid for with a price. I was bought and paid for with a price. That's a huge deal. Sometimes when you get up in the morning, you know, you may be having a really bad day and you may feel like you're completely out of sorts and you don't really know how you're supposed to do anything next. Just get to that place. Say to yourself out loud, man, whether I believe it or I don't believe it, I was bought and paid for with a price. When you get to that place and you were bought and paid for with a price and you're entirely free, you're also entirely bound to that Savior, takes me to a question about, like, how do I live a life of beauty? How do I live a life of beauty where what I'm doing is just beautiful, or what's happening in front of God and Jesus is really extraordinary? I live a life of beauty when I'm not afraid anymore. How do I become a servant? I think one simple way. Doesn't really matter how you serve. A simple way to understand how you become a servant in Jesus' world is you do one thing. One thing. You exchange power for love, and you exchange fear for security. You exchange power for love, and you exchange fear for security. Just think of how many relationships in your life you could change right now today if you just did that one thing. If you exchanged power for love and fear for security. Three challenges. Challenge number one. I want to challenge you to step into the arms of Jesus and to lay your fear down. Step into the arms of Jesus and lay your fear down. There's two of them. Third challenge is live knowing that you're safe. Live knowing that you're loved and live knowing that you're free. Don't have to be afraid. God's got it. You know, the fear that we have is telling us like God doesn't really have it though. It's like God's got it. That's the storyline on the end, isn't it? God's got it. God's got it. He's got it. I'm going to wake up tomorrow and I'm going to realize what? All the stuff I'm thinking about, all the stuff I'm trying to manage, God's got it. I'm free. Let's pray. Thanks so much, Jesus, for the time you spent with us. Loved being with you. Loved the way you challenge us. Love the way you speak into us. Now come and set us free. In your sweet name, amen. Thanks so much.
For that message one more time. We love you guys. We'll see you back here next week. Please enjoy the nice weather outside while it lasts, and we'll see you next time.